Futures climbed today after a huge spike last Friday. Stocks boosted by some strong bumps in Japan. So to get to the headline behind all of that, Mike Santoli from Yahoo Finance is joining us this Monday morning to break down the business headlines. Mike, did you have a good weekend?
I did. Thanks, Dan. How about you?
I certainly did as well. Looks like, you know, Wall Street's going to be enjoying a nice start back to the work
yes.
week. All right, so I want to get to some breaking news right now. Standard & Poor's revising the U.S.'s credit outlook. Good news, I'm guessing.
Definitely good news. Now, the market had kind of not paid too close attention to the downgrade the S&P assigned to the U.S. Credit rating a couple of years ago during the whole debt ceiling fight in recent years. Basically, the deficit's been getting smaller, and the economic cycle is helping out the whole federal finance story. So I don't think it's a big deal. It's sort of a gesture and acknowledgement by S&P that, in fact, the government's finances are not in as dire a state, at least in the short term. What's interesting is, you know, they kind of panicked, you can look back and say, by downgrading the U.S. government credit rating from the highest levels back when they did. But their reasoning was political dysfunction. Essentially, they didn't have the confidence that politicians were going to do what was necessary to secure the financial future of the government. I don't think that's much changed. What's changed is the economy's gotten better and federal tax receipts are better. So it's funny because the logic of the original downgrade seems to still apply. And in fact, if anything, this revision of the outlook to stable from negative by S&P is going to remove any possibility of a grand budget bargain, even if there was a possibility before.
Interesting to see the disconnect between what happens in Washington and what actually happens on Wall Street then.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. I mean, it's always been the case.
Yeah. Well, numbers don't lie, or at least they shouldn't in most cases. All right, so Japan today spiking because of their revised growth numbers. How good are they?
Well, pretty good. And boy, they better be good given the policies over there where they're trying to aggressively weaken the yen and print more money and get their economy moving again and reflate the whole market over there. So it is some good news recently that that growth is looking like it's actually picking up. To this point, it's mostly been about expectations that, in fact, these policies were going to kick in and it was going to work. So the market over there has been dancing around in these big daily jumps for a while now, which is a little bit disconcerting. You don't want to see a huge global asset market kind of whip around the way it has been doing. But at this point, it looks like there's a little more confidence that, in fact, the growth is going to be picking up. The big question is actually whether interest rates on Japanese government debt also go up a lot, which could actually sort of undercut the growth story. So it's kind of a delicate experiment that's being done over there. And I think that's why the markets have been so volatile from day to day.
But a nice feather in the cap for Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, though, and his Abenomics.
Without a doubt. Look, I mean, initially all he had to do was persuade the world markets that, in fact, he was serious about this and he was going to go all in on this plan. And that much certainly has been effective. And right now, people are giving him the benefit of the doubt.
All right. I want to talk for a minute about the national security, the NSA's PRISM program. Everyone is talking about, obviously, and looking at the political ramifications for that. But there's also some very financial ramifications that are happening, right? The EU clearly not happy with the latest revelations.
No, they're not. I mean, I think at this point, it sort of sits at the level of the understandable expressions of concern that any world kind of government body would put out there after you hear the news and after you hear about secret programs and potential for their citizens to have been swept up, we think, perhaps, in some of these sort of data mining operations. So at this point, I think it's going to be an issue. I think we're going to have a hashing out of kind of the rules of engagement here on this new world. And that's probably the process that grinds to a start at this point. I don't think it's going to be a high impact, at least in the coming G8 meeting or anything like that. But I do think it's going to be there. It's going to be one of the threads of discussion for a while.
Well, okay, you mentioned the G8 summit as far as the potential impact it may have. But what about right here at home, Silicon Valley specifically, Facebook, other tech giants? I mean, what kind of a financial reaction are they having to this?
Yeah, at the moment, not a big financial reaction, but I do think it certainly gets everybody thinking about, A, the vulnerability of these networks or the access that third parties have to these networks, and also kind of the bargain that all these tech companies implicitly strike with their users. So what is fair play? What is not fair play? Obviously, it's been a concern with social networks for a long time, exactly, you know, what people's private information is available to be used for advertising for other people. So I do think that whole thing has to be worked through with regard to the business models there. So it's not so much changing business today or changing their earnings or their outlook today, but I definitely think it's interesting that all the companies that that have come out with comments had very specific language about, you know, the government did not have direct access to our servers. So it seems like, you know, it's been this gray area that I think people want to have go either black or white.
Right, right. Good point. Apple has their developers conference kicking off today. A lot of people, a lot of Apple heads out there waiting to see what the new big gadget's going to be. What are we hearing?
Yep. You know, I actually think we're kind of past the point where Apple can, in one fell swoop, dazzle us with the next new thing. But I do think incrementally they have interesting things to offer us with iRadio, with streaming music, which has been long rumored. But the fact that it's kind of getting in motion is definitely interesting, could be disruptive to other music streaming services like Pandora. I do think we're going to get a little more about the operating system. It's very wonkish. It's behind the scenes. So I really feel like Apple is no longer one of those, you know, kind of what's the next blockbuster stories. It's so big and so dominant in so many areas. And the stock really, the fever has broken with regard to Apple shares. I mean, they've been kind of lolling around in this range for a little while now. Interestingly, they did not run up into the developers conference in past years, the prior weeks before the conference. They actually have run up. So it seems to me the market is not applying very high expectations or hopes on what specifically is going to be unveiled at the conference, which I think, you know, by reverse logic is good. Basically, we could be pleasantly surprised if we don't already have high hopes.
You know, what's fascinating is to see how the profile of the Apple investor has changed as the company has changed.
Yeah.
and evolved very, very rapidly.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, it's in the hands now of kind of your staid value investors, the ones who care about dividends and buybacks. And yes, they still, you know, worship sort of the cult of Steve Jobs, but that's not the reason that they own Apple stock. It's not necessarily number one for innovation, even though obviously plenty of that's going to be going on there behind the scenes.
All right, I want to talk for a minute about Google, because they may have stolen actually some of Apple's thunder, buying a social media navigation app Waze, but certainly paying top dollar for it.
Well, it seems to be, so top dollar is relative, right? $1.3 billion for this new sort of traffic navigation app is a lot of money, but Google's worth $300 billion in the stock market. It's got $40 billion in cash. One of the great things about, you know, having that kind of firepower and having that size and scale is you can make a bet on a great technology you would rather have than compete against, even if it costs $1.3 billion. So I do think the fact that there were other potential bidders involved here are interesting. And Google, I think, has been impressive in the way that they'll buy things and sort of let them incubate and integrate them as it makes sense and not necessarily say, give me a payoff this year. So I think over time, they'll figure out how to make either their map apps or advertising sales better and just the user experience better. So it seems to me like a pretty, you know, a pretty good use of some spare cash by Google.
Yeah, it can always be that double-edged sword of monetization immediately. All right, Mike, before I let you go, one last look at the Dow is up almost 27 points, 15,275. Mike Santoli from Yahoo Finance. Have a good Monday.
All right, thanks. You too.